justification to build up their military-industrial complex once again, just as China and Russia have been doing. But another one of these revelations that you may find interesting, David, because I think you've talked about this in the past, is that another one of the characters linked to funding these protest groups, these NGOs that started the Ukrainian revolution, is eBay founder Pierre Omidyar,
yes,
who basically covered the rest of the budget for this main umbrella protest group, Center UA. So yeah. 54% of it was paid for by the US State Department. The rest of it was paid for by this Pierre Omidyar. And he, of course, is also the billionaire owner of Glenn Greenwald and Jeremy Scahill's First Look Media Project, which, of course, controls all the Edward Snowden files.
Yes.
So I actually asked Greenwald about this on the weekend because he got some flack for this. And to some extent, I feel sorry for Greenwald because he gets a lot of flack about why don't you release all the Snowden files at once, which I think is a stupid move because that would ensure that it wouldn't stay in the media spotlight for an elongated amount of time, which it is at the moment because they're doling them out. But I think this was a genuine criticism because Greenwald wrote an article for his First Look website funded by this billionaire who is also funding the Ukrainian protesters. And he basically admitted that he did no research whatsoever on the political background of Pierre Omidyar.
Yeah.
Now, that seems very strange to me that you would have someone handing you $250 million to start a media project and that you wouldn't even research their political background. Now, that, he denied that, you know, it would interfere with his journalistic independence. He tweeted that back at me. But what if this individual was linked, for example, to neo-Nazis? I mean, that would impugn his work. That would smear yes. his work.
And it's very troubling to see this because, you know, we see that Pierre Omidyar is actually one of the largest globalist bankers with his involvement with PayPal. I mean, he is one of the major up-and-coming power bases here, along with people like Jeff Bezos, who paid $250 million for the Washington Post. Why? Because he wants to be a player in Washington. That's why, obviously. If you own the Washington Post, you've got a lot of clout in Washington. And so Pierre Omidyar, I think, kind of defensively started up this network that he put Glenn Greenwald and others in charge of and said, I'm going to spend $250 million. You know, I'm tit for tat type of thing. I'm not going to be left out of this. There's a competition between these Silicon Valley billionaires, and they understand the political importance of controlling the media. And that really is a bid that they're going for. And we see not only in the Ukraine, but Pierre Omidyar has got a terrible track record with microfinancing in India. The terrible things that happen to people there. I would encourage people to look that up. Look up microfinancing in India and see what happened with the Omidyar network in that area. That's very, very disturbing. It doesn't portray a picture of an altruistic, philanthropic billionaire like they like to portray Pierre Omidyar.
Well, that's right, David. And what confuses me is the fact that Greenwald said that he basically had no involvement in the political direction of this First Look Media project, which controls all the Snowden files. But then Scahill admitted separately, quote, Pierre writes more on our internal messaging than anyone else. Mm-hmm. So he has a direct and consistent hand in the direction of that media organization. So while Scahill constantly talks about, you know, being an adversarial role against the state, they're being funded by somebody who works with the US government to fund these regime change operations around the world. So that was very disconcerting for me. I did invite Greenwald on the show, which I previously believed he'd been reluctant to appear on the Alex Jones show in the past. He indicated that he would be willing to appear on the show. So we're trying to set that in motion. I said we'd get our guys to contact him. So the floor is open for him to respond on that. And even aside from that, I said it would be a great idea because you could reach a whole new audience anyway. So
yeah,
hopefully that can happen.
Well, it would be very interesting to have him on because I know he was singled out and attacked by Palantir and others. There were WikiLeaks put out the documents where they were plotting to do dirty tricks against him to assassinate his character. And then we see that in response to that, They tried to shut down WikiLeaks and so forth. All that stuff was happening. He mentioned Peter Thiel and his involvement with PayPal, but he didn't talk about Pierre Omidyar's involvement with the PayPal 14, you know, as a protest against the actions of Bank of America and PayPal and others. You had a lot of independent activists known as the PayPal 14 who did what they consider to be just a digital sit-in. They didn't affect any of the transactions that were going on in PayPal. They just basically took over PayPal's homepage that talked about the institution, which people don't typically go to. And they saw that, and their lawyer saw that, as the equivalent of a digital protest of somebody going into someone's restaurant and sitting at the counter because they won't serve black people or something like that. So that was the way they saw it. But they came after them, and Pierre Omidyar was a part of this. PayPal came after those protesters with very serious felony charges, and that drug on for years. So it'd be interesting to see how he views that kind of back and forth, you know, with the PayPal group, with WikiLeaks, with Julian Assange. It'll be interesting to see that happens. Hang on, Paul. We're going to be right back. We're going to have Paul Joseph Watson one more segment. And, Paul, I want to talk to you about this article you had today in InfoWars about the London mayor calling for the state to take children based on political beliefs of the parents. Because we've got a State Department and an administration, or I should call them a regime is a more accurate expression, but they are on the verge of creating a much larger war than just an internal conflict. This is a very dangerous brinksmanship. We've been talking about that with Paul Joseph Watson. We still have him on the phone. But, Paul, I would like to go over, and I'd like to change subjects now and talk about this article that's up on InfoWars today. The London mayor calls for the state to take children based on the parents' political beliefs. Now, you and I spoke last week, and we talked about how after a year, Scotland passed this bill that would assign a government minder to children at birth, and they would have someone from the government assigned to each child through the age of 18. And what an outrageous thing that was to the presumption that the state cared more about the children and knew better than the parents what that individual child needed. But you pointed out at the time that they had already done this, where they have gone after the political beliefs, taken a child away because of the parents' political beliefs, and it was something that was for the UK Independence Party, which is really a mainstream party. Now they're doubling down with these comments from the London mayor.
Well, that's right. First, to finish off on the previous subject, the Russian Defense Ministry is now actually denying the reports which were put out by Sky News and others that there's this 3 a.m. deadline on Russian forces seizing Ukrainian military bases in Crimea. So if true, that's good news that they haven't imposed that deadline, but we'll get that article up. But the London mayor, Boris Johnson, wrote in his weekly column that the law should obviously treat radicalization as a form of child abuse. And he's talking about using social services to target parents with, quote, extremist, radical political beliefs. And the example that he cited, of course, because it's the most justifiable, reasonable example, was extremist Muslims who might teach their children to become suicide bombers. Mm-hmm. But then if you read further down into the article, he also says that it could be applied under more vague circumstances, such as if the child is taught to be, quote, full of hate. Yes. And he actually linked that with the BNP, which is a right-wing British national party that vehemently opposes immigration, is linked with neo-Nazis. But you can see the slippery slope because, as you mentioned, in 2012 up in Rotherham, the local government council there removed two children from the care of foster parents who had an exemplary record due to the fact that they were members of UKIP, which is the third largest political party in Britain, expected to win the European parliamentary elections later this year. And the reason they gave for removing these kids from their care was the fact that they belong to a, quote, racist party. Yeah, and right. How they judged the fact that the party was racist was because its platform opposes the, quote, active promotion of multiculturalism. So if you oppose mass immigration and the imposition of multiculturalism, which even people like the German Chancellor Angela Merkel have denounced, that means you're a racist. Yes. So you can see how easily this could be applied to seize children from parents with extremist radical beliefs. Of course, according to the government and the establishment, a radical belief is something that differs from the PC orthodoxy, which as you've seen in America, with the Department of Homeland Security characterizing, quote, liberty lovers as extremists, you can see the slippery slope that this could well lead to.
Yes, we've seen that here in America, the Southern Poverty Law pimps have labeled mainstream evangelical groups as hate groups because they stand for traditional marriage. We'll be right back.
Thank you for listening to GCN. Visit GCNlive.com today.
Alex Jones here to tell you about how you can help spread liberty worldwide while also enjoying what I have found to be the best tasting 100% organic coffee on the planet. For more than a decade, my favorite coffee has come from the high mountains of southern Mexico, where the Chiapas farmers grow their unique shade-grown Arabica beans. We have now managed to secure these sought-after beans in a highly customized blend. Discover and try a bag of the Patriot Blend 100% organic coffee at InfoWarsLife.com. This coffee gives you a long, smooth pick-me-up for hours without the headaches and heartburn that so many other coffees give me personally. Hands down, this is my favorite coffee, and it's taken us years to secure connections directly to the Chiapas Mexican farmers. Drop by the site today, order a bag or two, and I don't think you're going to be disappointed. Available in original or with our immune support infusion blend, you will be supporting a free press, all the while enjoying a truly great-tasting